lineage of David, to be registered with Mary, his betrothed wife, who was with a child. So it was that when they were there, the days were completed for her to be delivered. And she brought forth her first son, and wrapped him in swaddling clothes, and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn. Now there were in the same country shepherds living out of the fields, keeping watch over their flocks by night. And behold, an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were greatly afraid. Then the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. Behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which you repeat to all people. For there is born to you this day, in the city of David, a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. And this will be the sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angels a multitude of the heavenly hosts, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill towards men." So it was when the angels had gone away from them unto heaven, that the shepherds said to one another, "Let us now go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has come to pass, which the Lord has made known to us." And they came with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the baby lying in a manger. Now when they had seen him, they made widely known the saying which was told them concerning this child. And all those who heard it marveled at those things which were told them by the shepherds. But Mary kept all these things and pondered them in her heart. Then the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things that they had heard and seen, as it was told them. Our Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you this wonderful afternoon. Thank you for giving us this season of Christmas as we meditate upon your word. We welcome your Holy Spirit to continue ministering to us, O God, so that we may understand the real meaning of this season. We bless you and we glorify your name. Thank you, Holy Spirit, because you are here and you have taken over. In the name of Jesus, we pray.
Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So I want us to learn something about this season of Christmas. During the season of Christmas, people who come from different parts of the country, they travel to their up country so that they can celebrate Christmas with their family members. Those students who are at school, they celebrate Christmas in different ways. They make a party, they celebrate, they cook a chapati, they cook everything so that they can celebrate Christmas. Which other thing is eaten in Christmas? What else is eaten in Christmas? What else? What else is eaten during Christmas? Chapati and all those things. People celebrate Christmas in different ways. But I want us to understand the deeper meaning and the deeper understanding of this season of Christmas. Because people celebrate this season out of ignorance. Somebody said, Christ is the reason for the season. And truly, Jesus Christ is the reason for the season of Christmas. So we hear in chapter 2 from verse 1 that, "And it came to pass in those days that a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be registered." This census first took place while Quirinius was governing Syria. So all went to be registered, everyone to his own city. So people went back to their cities to be counted. Census was going on. Everyone was going to be counted. And I was reading one of the theologians was saying, this was not just about getting the number of people. getting the number of population. This was about taxing them so that every one of them will pay tax. So all went to be registered, everyone to his own city. Joseph also went up from Galilee, out of the city of Nazareth, into Judea, to the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and the lineage of David. And therefore Joseph also went back to his home city, hometown, so that he can also be counted. The distance between these cities from where Joseph came out of Galilee, from Nazareth up to Bethlehem, they say it is around like 27 kilometers, like almost 30 kilometers. From here to Gilgil, like from here to Gilgil, it's past Naivasha, before Nakuru. Nakuru is like 180 or 60 kilometers. And therefore, it's a distance like from here. Those who know this way is up to around the Gilgil. So it's not a short distance. It took time for Joseph and the pregnant woman to go to the hometown so that they can be counted. As you all know, the means of transport during that time, it was not like the advanced world where we can take minutes to for you to reach Gilgil. In fact, it's seconds for you to be in Gilgil. But the baby, it was on foot or in a donkey. That was very tedious kind of a journey. And therefore, Joseph, together with Mary, they started the journey to go back to the city of David so that they can be counted. So it was a long distance for them to go so that they can be counted. And as you know very well, the woman was pregnant. To be registered with Mary, his betrothed wife, who was with a child. Sometimes, you know, the English of the Bible, you need to understand the English of the Bible. When the Bible was talking who was with a child, it doesn't simply mean that he was carrying a child who had already been born. But she was bearing, he was having a child not yet reached the time of delivery. So it was that while they were there, the days were completed for her to be delivered. While they were there, the days for her to be delivered were completed. It simply means even when they went to that hometown of Bethlehem, maybe they stayed there for a period of time. Maybe we can say when they went there, Mary was like 7 months pregnant. So they went to Bethlehem and stayed there like for 2 months more. We can say something like they stayed for a period of time, and therefore it reached a time when it was ready, time for delivery of the child. So the Bible says, so it was that while they were there, the days were completed for her to be delivered. So the Bible was talking while they were there. I'm not having full information. Were they already numbered or they had not been numbered? That information is limited for me here to understand when the time for Mary to deliver the child, were they already numbered or they were not yet numbered? And she brought forth her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling cloths and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn. When the time for her to deliver arrived, when the time came for her to deliver, the Bible says that he brought forth her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling cloths. Swaddling cloths, some gave interpretation about this coming from a Greek word, swaddling cloths, torn cloths, kind of cloths, simply meaning Joseph was not coming from a rich family. When someone is expecting a baby, you go to the market, let's say you go to toy market, you look for towels, you look for clothes, you know all those clothes which are needed for preparing for the birth of the child. This was not the case with Joseph. Being coming from a poor family, maybe he torn one of his trousers. Because they were going for censor, They were not prepared, not knowing during the time of censor, that is the time Jesus is going to be delivered. And therefore, they were not prepared for it, maybe, because of the family background coming from poor family. Even if they were prepared, but materially or physically, they had no ability to prepare for the coming child. So they wrapped the baby in swaddling cloths and laid him in a manger. In a manger where the animals were being fed. Because the Bible says, because there was no room in the inn. Because there was no room in a hotel. The hotel was, the city of Bethlehem was full of people. And because everyone has come from this, from every city, they have come back to their homes. The town was full of children. They were playing. The city, the guest rooms were full. People who had money, they booked early in advance. Maybe 3 months before, people booked. And they said, this kind of a hotel is booked for this team. This hotel is already booked for this team. When the time came for Jesus to be born, there was no room in the hotel. The hotel was completely occupied by visitors, by people who came to the city to be counted. What does that teach us as children of God? We are living in an era where there's no room for Jesus in our lives. We are living in an era where a lot of things are occupied in our lives. We look at your program every day. You look at your program every month. You look at your program every year. In all those programs, where is Jesus in your life? This should be a question for you and for me. When you are going to for your workplace from Monday to Saturday, where is Jesus? Does Jesus has room even in that program of yours? The joy of the Lord, Jesus has got a room in your life. This should be a question for you and for me. As you are leaving and go out to look for food for your children, to go to your workplace, maybe you have got a business, you open your business on a daily basis, from Monday to Saturday. Does Jesus has room in that program of yours? Maybe the program is of feasting people. Maybe a part of that program is cooking food. Maybe part of that program is washing utensils. Maybe part of that program is washing clothes. Maybe part of that program is doing a lot of activities. Sweeping the house is part of that program. In all those programs, where is the program for Jesus? The great Messiah is being born, but there's no room for him. There was room for visitors. There was room for other people, but Jesus had no room. Let it be not that way in our lives. When we have got a lot of activities, when we are tiny, during this time of Christmas, let Jesus have room in our lives. Amen. Let us know that Jesus has got great room, good room in our lives. And because there was no room, Jesus was supposed to be born in a manger. Was supposed to be born in a place that was dirty. It reveals a lot about this family of Joseph. If they were rich people, they would have booked a hotel in advance. So when they were coming, they just come to a hotel directly. But because it's a poor family, because the family has got not enough resources, and it's time to deliver, there's no option, but Jesus was born and was wrapped in swaddling clothes and laid in a manger. And laid where the environment was not good for this child. You know, when a child is born in a civilized world, civilized society, a lot of care is done to that child. Immediately the child is born, the nurse makes sure that the child is breathing well. If there is a problem with the breathing, he makes sure that the nose of the child is completely open so that the child can breathe well. The child is put in an environment where there's warmth. A lot of things are done for the comfort of this child. But this one was a very hostile environment. The child is born, but there is no place to put this child, and he was laid in a manger. Now they were in the same country, shepherds living outside the field, keeping watch over their flocks by night. Can you feel something that maybe Jesus was born at night? Maybe something of that kind. From where we are reading, we can be able to depict, we can be able to make some conclusion, but maybe he was born at night from this story. And now, they were in the same country, shepherds living outside, out in the field, keeping watch over their flocks by night. Shepherds during the time of the Jews were people with the low estate. Shepherds were people who were not regarded in a society. People of low class were the shepherds. People who were not recognized in the society. The low class people were shepherds. During the time Jesus was born, the Bible is recording that in that same country, we had some shepherds at night who were in the field taking care of the flocks. I was asking myself, while this shepherd being censored, it maybe means they were not considered they need to be counted. So let them continue feeding the flocks. While people are in the city being counted, everyone, the shepherds were not recognized at all. These people who were not recognized, people who were not honored, were in the field taking care of the flocks. So the Bible says, at that same time when Jesus was born, shepherds were in the field in the midst of night, were taking care of the flocks. No wonder the hymn was singing about, it was a silent night. Now they were in the same country, shepherds living out in the field, keeping watch over their flocks by night. And behold, an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were greatly afraid. When you are a shepherd, let me talk about from a shepherd, maybe when you are a guard, when you are a soldier, you take care of somebody's property at night. When you are on a night shift, when it reaches around like 3 a.m., it is the coldest time. During night, the condition is not good at all. It's very cold. Sometimes I used to get this information that they used to lit fire so that they can warm themselves. And so the environment is so horrific. The environment is tough. We are now living in a city where when you wake up like 3 a.m., you can see the light. One day when we were in, when I was in the village, we used to go very early in the morning to pray. And we used to walk a very long distance, like from here up to Kawangwan, like this side. So we wake up very early in the morning, like 5 a.m. In total darkness, you go to pray. And so one day, my bigger brother was already in that place. He spent a night there. And so I had to wake up, only I, to go to pray. I don't know, fortunately or unfortunately, I was not having a watch. So I just woke up and said, it's around 5 a.m. So I started the journey to go and pray. So during when I was walking, total darkness, it was like my ears became very cold. You don't see anything. Silent night. Very quiet. No birds. No voice at all. Nothing at all. So I walked. They walked for that distance walking. Just walking. I was in class 7 by then. I think at what age? The age of 30 years. I was that age. So I walked that night, walking that distance. The environment is completely quiet. We took the total darkness. So when I arrived at the house, when I knocked at the door, my brother opened the door for me and they started laughing. I said, what is the problem? They said, have you looked at the time? It was around 2 a.m. It was around 2 a.m. And then because they said, not because you have come, I just pray that we got to sleep again. It was not east at all. So during this time of the shepherds, there was total darkness. Nothing was going on at all. Everything was quiet. This is the time Jesus was born. Therefore, the shepherds were taking care of the flocks during the night. Maybe during the day they go and have a rest. And because they are not recovered, people who are recovered in a society, they don't work at night. People who have money, they don't work at night. They work during the day, just a few hours. But in the night, they rest. But maybe for us, maybe who are struggling in one way or another, you go extra mile into work. And so this was the situation of the shepherds. They were working. They were taking care of the flocks during the middle of the night. When it was silent, everything was quiet. But the good thing is, and behold, an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were greatly afraid. Thanks be to God, even during the silent night, even when everything was completely quiet, even when there was total darkness, still the glory of the Lord appeared to these low estate people. Even when it was the coldest season, there was total darkness, but the glory of the Lord still appeared to these people. And they were greatly afraid. Then the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. Behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which will be to all people." Don't be afraid. I know you did not expect this. You were only expecting cold. You were only expecting darkness. You are only expecting hostile environment. Don't be afraid because of seeing the glory. You are not expecting this glory, but don't be afraid. The season of Christmas is the season which we need to see the glory of God in our lives. We need to experience the glory of God in our lives. It's not just about nyama choma. It's not just about the kuku. It's not just about the chapati. It's not just about the soda. Season of Christmas is the season we need to see the glory of God in our lives. It is the season of the glory of God. It is the season we need to experience God in our lives. This is the true meaning of Christmas. Some people, because of ignorance, even including those who don't know anything about Christ, they have arranged parties, they bought soda, beer, and all manner of things are happening. Statistics has it that during the season of Christmas, a lot of evil things happen. Robbery during the night of Christmas happens all over. Sexual immorality happens at largest during the season of Christmas. People confront the season of Christmas to commit sin. The season of Christmas is for us to see the glory of God in our lives. The season of Christmas is for us to experience God in our lives. It's more than chapati. Christmas is more than celebrating. Christmas is more than balloon. Christmas is to experience the glory of God. The beautiful glory of God in our lives. Christmas is a season for us to see the glory of God. For us to walk with God more. For us to see God more in our lives. Amen. Maybe you have walked through darkness. You have not seen God during these other days. But during the season of Christmas, you need to see the glory of God. Amen. Darkness has to come to an end in your life. You need to see the glory of God. Amen. During this season of Christmas, darkness has to come to an end in your life. And you need to experience the glory of God. The angel said to the shepherds, do not be afraid because you are not expecting glory. Do not be afraid because this season you are only expecting darkness. Do not be afraid because this season you are only expecting cold. But this season is a glorious one. Because the child is born, a glory. Glory has to be revealed. Because God is in control of our hearts. God is being revealed in our hearts. Glory must be revealed. I used to have one man in somewhere I was living, just within this area of satellite, in another place. This person, every Christmas, he runs mad. Every Christmas, he runs mad. So after Christmas, the new year, he becomes normal. He becomes normal January, February, March, April, May, June, July, August, September, October, November. December, he runs mad. He started walking naked, beating people. And therefore, the family members, this was only the expectation. During Christmas, this is what we will undergo. This is, during Christmas, we will have it rough in this house. He was the man of the family. Like 55 years. Every Christmas, they will tie his hands and his legs so that he don't get lost. But the rest of the month, the man is very normal. He makes his shoes and then he does some businesses over there. But during Christmas, he runs mad. I want to encourage you, a child of God, this wonderful morning. During the time of Christmas, we should not experience darkness. During Christmas, that is the time we need to see the glory of God in our lives. Amen. It's the time to experience God in a great way in our lives. Amen. As people are celebrating the wrong way, as people are expecting calamities, as people are expecting bad things to happen, we are to expect the glory time in the presence of God. That is why even we with the revelation of our founder, it was very necessary that we have the Christmas retreat. When people are cheering up to celebrate in a wrong way, we are celebrating the glory of God. Amen. We are spending time in the house of God. Amen. When others are preparing to spend Yamachoma and they drink, they become drunk, beat each other, it's totally different with us. We want to experience the glory of God. Amen. During this time of Christmas, go to the hospital. That's when you will know people are misusing or they're using Christmas the wrong way. People full of injuries, cutting each other with bottles of beer, accident on the road, even during Christmas, even this country. This month of December, in this country, a lot of accident happens, and not only in Kenya. All over, the spirit of bloodshed, the spirit of immorality, and the spirit of darkness takes control of the world. But during this time, we are not supposed to experience darkness. We are supposed to experience the glory of God. Amen. And behold, an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord stood around them. And they were greatly afraid. Then the angel said to them, do not be afraid. Behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which will be to all people. Amen. I bring you good news. Christmas is about good news. Christmas is about the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. It's not only about the food. Christmas is about the good news. The angel said, don't be afraid. The glory of God comes with the good tidings, the good news. When we experience the glory of God, that is the time we receive the good news. We are here every day meditating about the good news of the kingdom of God. Christmas is about the good news of the kingdom of God. When you switch on the television in the evening, you will hear about other news, Other news stations, they every day you will see them
breaking news. Breaking news.
But with us, during Christmas season, is the season for
good news,
not breaking news. It's the season for good news, not breaking news. It's the season to share the love of God. It's the season to share the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. Much as we are sharing means, but that is very important. But the most important is sharing the good news.
Amen.
The angel said, don't be afraid. Don't worry at all, because I have brought you the good news. During the season of Christmas is the season of good news.
Amen.
Which will be for the whole people. For there is born to you this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord.
Amen.
When the angel was bringing this news to the shepherds who were in darkness, I was asking myself, people who are in that city of Bethlehem, did they get this news? Why they have this information? From the explanation of this Bible, definitely they had no idea that a Savior has been born. The first people to receive this news were the people who were lowly considered. Breaking news, first of all, it reaches people who are civilized, who have got smartphones. Breaking news reaches people who have got televisions. Breaking news reaches people who are civilized, but the low estate people who are not considered. No wonder the Bible talks about that God does not show partiality. Even people of the low estate can receive this news. Breaking news reaches faster to technologically advanced people, but this is different with the good news. Good news, it reached faster to people who are not considered in a society. God does not go with what we see physically. Maybe we also consider people who have got money and say these are the people who are supposed to be closer to God. They are more holier. Maybe people in suits. Maybe people with a higher level of education. But the good news of the kingdom of God reached fast to people who are in darkness, to people who are taking care of the flocks instead of the people who are in the city. For there is born to you this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. And this will be the sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. This will be a sign to you. The servant of God was ministering to us the other day about this one. This will be a sign unto you. You will find a baby boy wrapped in swaddling clothes, laying in a manger. This will be a sign. The sign of the good news. The sign of glorious moment. The sign from heaven did not come the powerful way. Did not come the terrifying way. But the angel said, this will be a sign. You will find a baby wrapped in swaddling clothes, laying in a manger, in a low estate, in a despised place. Something good can come out of that despised environment. Irrespective of the level of your education, irrespective of your background, where you are born, maybe no one in your family has ever gone even to standard A. Maybe in your family no one has ever bought, leave alone a motorbike, even a bicycle. No one has ever bought this. Even that environment which does not look like it has got a hope at all, the angel said, this shall be a sign to you. You will find a child wrapped in swaddling clothes, laid in a manger. That despised environment, something good, a sign from heaven can be revealed. Something good can come out of that environment which is despised. So I want to encourage you, a child of God, this wonderful morning. Be encouraged in the Lord. The way you are with that level of education, from that family background you come from, maybe you come from the background where people are witches. Maybe you come from the background where people are thieves. Maybe you come from the background where people are prostitutes. I want to encourage you. This good news, when it is in your heart, when it is controlling your life, when the good news is in your life, a sign from heaven can come from that small environment. Amen. God can take you to nations of the world if you continue to believe in this. Amen. And this will be the sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in swaddling clothes lying in a manger. And suddenly, there was with the angel a multitude of heavenly hosts, praising God and saying. When the angel was explaining to the shepherd about this, the Bible says suddenly, heavenly hosts and the army of angels came down and they were singing. Heavenly hosts, a great band, a great battalion, a great team of heavenly hosts, with all beautiful singing and beautiful instruments of singing to God, of glorifying God. The angels, the heavenly hosts, they came and they were singing, they were praising God, and they were saying, glory to God on the highest, and on earth, peace and goodwill towards men. Amen. The angels, the angel of God, they were singing, glory to God in the highest, and peace on earth. For peace to be on earth, first of all, God must be glorified first. You want to have peace in your life? Let God be glorified in your life. You may be looking, you see these people who are kings and spades on that big, they have got everything. They have the bed which you can turn, they just twist somewhere and it turns the way they want. They don't need to turn like this. They just switch patterns for things to happen. If they want some food from the table, their tables, they are very advanced. They prepare a meal, something beautiful there, and then they, a button, just cook when the cook is there, then it lands, it comes here on the plate here. So when Bilal is the other side, then he comes here. People, they live that kind of, but those things, they don't guarantee you peace. People with big vehicles all over the world, but they are dying miserable life. The source of peace is glorified God. When God is glorified in our lives, we get peace. When God is glorified in our lives, we are at peace. The source of peace is God. The source of peace is not money. The source of peace is not education. The source of peace is not the level of education and many other things. Coming from a rich family, we hear of many people even committing suicide, shooting and killing each other because they lack the inner peace. This inner peace we are talking about, it comes as a result of God being glorified in your life. Amen. When God is glorified in your life, automatically you will have peace. Amen. The heavenly host that you are singing, glory in the highest, and on earth, peace to men. Amen. When God is glorified, there will be peace. You want peace in your marriage? You want peace in your marriage? May let God be glorified in your life. Glory in the highest and peace on earth. Goodwill towards men. This is the song of the heavenly hosts. In other words, the angel they were singing, the only way for many to be at peace, if they glorify God. The only way for many to be at peace is to glorify God. When God is glorified, men will be at peace. When glory goes up towards God, peace comes to men. People are using other means to get peace. Political parties, they are making treaties to make peace. Nations, they are sitting on the table every day discussing, looking for peace. And some, they are arming themselves with weapons. They think it's the source of peace. The more they make weapons, the more there is conflict in those countries. Poor countries, they say, when we get oil in our country, we have peace. When they discover oil, instead of getting peace, conflict between themselves. That means oil, riches, is not the source of peace. Poor families, they say, maybe we are having conflict in our family because our land is very small, and therefore we are fighting for this small piece of land. Court rich families, they are in court every day fighting for riches. That means riches is not the source of peace. Do you want to have peace? Let God be glorified in your life. So it was when the angel had gone away from them into heaven that the shepherds said to one another, "Let us now go to Bethlehem." Angel, they are saying to one another, "Let us therefore go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has come to pass, which the Lord has made known to us." When the angel had left, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go and see these things." The season of Christmas is to encourage one another, let us go in the house of the Lord. Season of Christmas is to encourage one another, like the shepherds, they said to one another, "Let us go and see these things. Let us go and see with our own eyes these glorious things that God has done." We have been informed about this Christmas. We have known about this Christmas. During this season of Christmas, tell your children, "Let us go in the house of the Lord." Amen. Tell your brothers and sisters, during Christmas, "Let us go and hear the word of God." Amen. Christmas is not about going to bar. Christmas is about going to see what God has done.
Amen.
It's to hear from the Lord. So you have done the right thing to come here. God bless you.
Amen.
Let us go and see these things which angels have told us. The angels, they were saying to one another, "Let us go and see these things which the angel has told us." That the angel of the Lord, it came to pass. We go and see these things which have come to pass, which the Lord has made known to us. These things were made known to people who were of the low estate. The mystery of the kingdom of God can be revealed to you. You can be able to know the secret of the kingdom of God. To know the secret and the mystery of the kingdom of God is not about the level of your education. It's not about your background. It's about the fear of God in you.
Amen.
It's about humbleness. Shepherds say represent humility. Shepherds represent people who are humble, people who are down to earth. The Bible says in the book of James that humble yourself under the mighty hand of God, and he shall lift you in due time. Because God hates the pride, but gives grace to the humble.
Amen.
Shepherds, they represent humble people. Do you want God to reveal more and more to you, himself to you? Do you want to know more and more about God? When you humble, God will reveal himself to you. This was the problem with the Jews, what we have just started in the book of Romans chapter 1 up to chapter 8. This was the great problem with the Jews. They considered themselves special people. Because they were coming from the lineage of Abraham, so they considered themselves, "We are already the children of God. Even if we sin, we are already the children of God." Even when Jesus was giving them the truth, he said, "No, we know Abraham is our father. What are you telling us? You want to say that you are older than our father Abraham? You are born recently. We know your parents. Is that Joseph? You know that carpenter? That carpenter there, Kawangwara was satellite. You know that carpenter? The man that does like this. That's your father. We know your brothers. Your brothers, we have been playing with them here, Kawangwara. We know them very well." You can't say that a sinner can come from that kind of a family or that kind of background. Humility is the beginning of experiencing God in your life. And they came with haste. They came quickly and found Mary and Joseph and the baby laying in a manger. They came quickly with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the baby lying in a manger. These humble people, these people of humility, the despised one, when they were given that information, the Bible says they came with haste. They came quickly. They did not consume a lot of time. We hear many people when you are preaching to them about Christianity, they say, I'm still a young man. Let me continue to enjoy life fast. I think I want to know more about God when I am like 50, 70 there. Many people, they don't want God in their lives, even if you preach about them about Christianity or about the gospel. They don't want the gospel. They don't want Christ in their lives. But when they are old, they spend their time when they are strong, serving the devil. But when they are old, or they can't speak like this. That's when you will see on that deathbed, on that oxygen machine, that is when they will see. They will not say, God, call for me my mother or my father. They will say, call for me a pastor. Call for me a preacher to tell me something. Because they don't want their soul to perish. Because at last they have realized the solution is a preacher. One who is talking about God. Why should you wait for your body almost about to decay? That is when you give God your body. Give God your body when it is still strong. Why do you allow the devil to use your body when you are strong? Give God that body. John says, I write to you, a young man, because you are strong and the word of God lives in you. And another verse, he said, I write to you, young men, because you have overcome the world. Strength we need to use to overcome the world, not to be used by the devil. Therefore, the angel, they said, let us hurry up and see and go and see these things. Let us not waste time with the gospel. Let us not postpone the work of God. Don't postpone the calling of the Lord. You are saying, I'm just young, I don't have a big family. Let me just wait until I get married, I get children. That is where you can get serious with God. The angel said, let us go quickly. Hurry up, bless the God. We don't have much time. I want to encourage you and challenge you. Don't waste the time. Every opportunity you get, serve the Lord. Oh, now I'm having children. I cannot go to church. Anyway, I raise my children up. And I start going to church. Oh, blah, 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 blah. I can't do this right now. Anyway, something or this one. Don't waste any opportunity. The shepherds say to one another, let us not waste the time. Don't waste the time. God is calling on you. Now when they had seen him, I'm about to finish. Verse 17. And now when they had seen him, they made widely known the saying which was told them concerning the child. When they saw the child, they made another step. When they saw the child, they took another step. That was not the end of it. When they saw the child, they take it to the next level to make that child be known. When you have received Jesus in your life, when Jesus is born in your life, that should not be the end. In fact, that should be the beginning of making him known. As you can see behind there, that is our motto. To know God, to make him known. Not just knowing God and you left it there and you remain there. The most important part, it is only to know God. But the other very, very important part is to make him known. When the angels came and they saw the child there, they take it to the next level. They said, we are going to spread all over the world about this news. And all those who heard about it, let me repeat verse 17 first. Now when they had seen him, they made widely known the same which was told them concerning the child. They made it widely known. Now their status has changed. They are now no longer taking care of the flocks because they have seen the glory of God. Because they have experienced God in their lives, now their status has changed. They are no longer experiencing the cold season in the night, but they are the vessels of the gospel. They are telling everyone all over the world the good news. Christmas is the season to spread the good news. Christmas is the season to tell the whole world the love of God. Christmas is the season to tell your members of your family about Christ. Tell your members of your family. Share with your parents if they are not born again. Share with them the love of God. Extend to people you are staying with in the same plot. Share with them about the love of God. Extend the same. Take it to the whole world. When you have seen him, share him. When you have seen God in your life, share God.
Amen.
Share about him.
Amen.
And all those who heard it marveled at those things which were told them by the shepherds. But Mary kept all these things and pondered them in her heart. Then the shepherd returned, glorifying and praising God for the things they had heard and seen, as it was told. In all this process of spreading Christianity and telling the gospel, we are simply glorifying God. Christmas is the season that God needs to be glorified in our lives.
Amen.
Christmas is an opportunity God has given us that we should glorify him. As I want to wind up my message, I want to ask you this question. Is God glorified in your life? Are you living a life which glorifies God? Can we see the glory of God in your life? When the people you are staying with in that plot you are staying, in that estate you are staying, can people see the glory of God in your life? Can people see the glory of God in that house? This is another opportunity I want to challenge you. If they have not been seeing that glory, from today when you go, let the people who are around you see the glory of God in your life. The angel, the shepherds returned praising God. They were shouting, they were singing to the Lord. God was being glorified by these angels again. Being glorified more and more. I want to encourage you, during this season of Christmas, this is the season that God needs to be glorified more and more in our lives. In our families, God needs to be glorified more. Let us stand up on our feet. And as we pray, I know God has spoken to you in one way or another. You know your situation, you know your life, you know the state of your heart. You know how your life has been. Maybe from January up to now December, you've never went to church. Maybe from January up to now December, you've never read the Bible. You have never wanted to associate yourself with the things of God. Don't worry, that was the season of darkness. That was the season of coldness. But this afternoon, the gospel has reached us that we want to see the glory of God. Forget the past. God is opening a new chapter in your life.
Amen.
God is opening a new chapter in your life.
Amen.
Don't worry about your past, what you have gone through. Don't worry about the shame. The minister in the morning was quoting the book of Revelation that he is going to wipe away their tears. Weeping may endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning. Don't worry about what you have gone through. You may have gone through misery. You may have gone through embarrassment. You may have gone through the shame. That was the season of darkness in your life. But behold, this afternoon, the angel of the Lord has brought light, and the glory of the Lord is going to be revealed in your life again.
Amen.
As you believe together with me this afternoon, If there is anyone, I don't want to end this without praying for someone who wants to make a total commitment with God. If there is anyone who attended this service of Christmas and you have never given your life to Jesus Christ, I want to give you this opportunity. I want to give you this time. If there is anyone, I want to pray together with you. This can be the turning point of your life, like it was the turning point of the shepherds. Is there anyone who is not born again and you want to receive Jesus in your life as your personal Savior? Maybe you have been living in darkness, but today the word of God has spoken unto you and you have got a repentant heart within you and you say, from today, I want the glory of God to be in my life. Maybe only quarrels have been going on in your life. The neighbors in your plot will know that you have come back when they see quarrels. Maybe every time you go back in your plot from your work, it's quarrels with your wife, it's quarrels with your husband, only quarrels with your children. But today is a turning point. They will no longer see quarrels. They will see the glory of God in that marriage.
Amen.
If there is anyone who needs that kind of prayer, lift up your hands and I will pray together with you. We are all born again. If there is anyone who needs that kind of prayer, you lift up your hands and I'll pray together for you. Thank you. Thank you. We are all born again. Is God being glorified in our lives? Have we wasted time to do the work of evangelism? When did you last evangelize? When did you last tell people about the love of God? Your workmates, your age mates, schoolmates, when did you last tell them about the love of God? May God help us this afternoon. In the name of Jesus. Father, we thank you for ministering to us. We thank you for the power of your word this afternoon. We have lived in darkness, but today you have rebuked us. You have given us the revelation about this Christmas, that this is the season for the glory of God to be revealed in our lives, for people to experience the glory of God in our lives. From today, thank you for ministering to us. And with a repentant heart, with the help of your Holy Spirit, help us from today, like these shepherds of God, help us that we may make known what you have revealed to us. Help us to spread the gospel, O God, knowing that we don't have much time. We repent for postponing this for many times. We repent for not doing your work, saying we have got enough time. Like this shepherd, they knew the secret, and they hurriedly went to see Jesus. Help us to hurry up. Help us to count our days, not knowing we don't have enough time. Even like John the Baptist said to the people, repent for the kingdom of God is at hand.
Amen.
Help us, O God, so that we may tell others about the kingdom of God.
Amen.
Father, we thank you and we bless your name. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you. God bless you all.